All right, let us start the discussion today. So we'll talk about representation of numbers. So this is where we finished last time. And I will, as always, recapitulate what we did last time and then continue from there. So please open your own Jamboards so that everything happens smoothly for you. Now, the two key points that one need to remember while we are discussing the representation of numbers is that the computers store numbers in memory and it has a finite memory. So computers has finite memory. So finite memory leads to a finite precision, because you can only store those many numbers. The second key point is that all the modern day digital computers work with transistors. So they operate like switches, binary switches. And the switches are, they have only two states. So the way it is easier to represent numbers in computer is in binary base or base 2. So you have to use binary representations. So which means now, as we discussed last time, so one letter if you wish. So one letter will correspond to one place in memory or one switch. So this I can represent like pictorially by a small box like this. And this box can store the number because it's binary. Either it will be 0 or 1. All the switch will be on and off. So this will be 0 or 1. So this we call bits. So that the symbol is a small b. So this is one bit. So 8 places in memory is often clubbed together. If you call this a letter, this can be called as a word. So this is 8 places. This can hold 8 bits. So that is called a byte, which is written with capital B. Right, so this all we discussed last time, and we discussed that if I talk about 1 kilobyte, so how much bytes are there in 1 kilobyte? It's 1024 bytes, because that is easy if you are doing 2 to the power things. Capital B for bytes, small b for bits. Okay, so these are the things we discussed last time already. So how will one number look like here? So it will only can look like 1011100. So that will be 1 8-bit or 1 byte of information stored in the memory. Now this information, as you can see, is in ones and zeros. I can interpret these ones and zeros indifferently. So interpretation of this information is how I represent a number. Right? So that is how we will learn that how we represent integer numbers and decimal numbers, or decimal, or it can be a binary fractions. So integer numbers or fractional numbers in computer. So that is what we are going to learn today. So any questions so far? So let's start with the integer representations. Going to the next page. Long time ago, when it was not discovered that how you do subtraction, it will suffice only if you want to do addition to have, and you don't need negative integers. So it will suffice to have only positive integers. So the positive integers obviously doesn't have any sign. So those can be represented directly, so to say, directly within quotes in a computer. So we'll call those unsigned integers. So let's take, so this cannot have subtraction. So let me keep this here. So can you tell me, one of you, that where this type of integer can be useful, where I cannot do subtraction? So tell me an operation where I can still use the positive integers only, I will not do subtraction. Somebody. Suraj. Vahal.
Yes, sir. So by operation, do you mean like multiplication and all kind?
Multiplication, okay. Fine. So if you are not multiplying negative numbers, so then it is okay. But I am asking for an example. Multiplication is an operation, right? Example means that I want to use mathematics to do some physical things, right? So what physical things you do where you don't need subtraction? Simple thing, counting. So if I want to count how many people are there in a crowd, I will never need to subtract, right? I will just add up one with the previous number. Okay. So this is mostly used in counting. So here I can use n bits. The unsigned integer will start from zero. And can you guess what is the maximum bit that it can store? Sorry, maximum number it can store. So, like if I have 2 bits.
N to the power 2? No.
Sir. No. So, 2 bits can store how many? What is the maximum number it can store? So, this can be 00, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. So, what is 1, 1?
2 to the power n.
1, 1 is 2 to the power n.
2 to the power n minus 1.
2 to the power n minus 1. It's clear? So because you are starting from 0, you cannot just go to 2 to the power n, you have to subtract 1. Okay. Remember, this is one of the reasons why your array indices in a C or any other, I mean, Python starts from zero. Fortran, it starts from one. But anyway, so this we understand that it will go from this to this. Okay. How am I representing this, the number x here, an integer number x? So let me keep a suffix capital I over here, which says that it's an integer. So this we have discussed earlier. So it is d to the dm, 2 to the m plus dot 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 dot, etc. So I'll have many such things up to 2 to the 0. This DMs are the digits of the number. Okay. So this is unsigned integer. It's only used for very specific cases. But then most of the cases we need. Okay. So one thing we realize here that there is a maximum unsigned integer, maximum value of unsigned integer. So what happens once I am counting? If it goes past that maximum value, what happens then?
It will reset to zero, right?
Right. So let's take an example. So what happens? If we keep on adding, so 2 bits is easiest to see. So first the number is 0, 0. You add 1, you get 0, 1. You add 1, you get 1, 0. You add 1, you get 1, 1. With 1, 1, you add 1. So 1, 1 is 0. Then 1, 1 is 0. And you have this extra 1. But because of finite precision, you cannot save more than this. So you will get back 0. Okay, so this type of addition is sometimes called modulo addition. So it's a modulo 3 addition. So if you go over 3, it will reset to 0. Can you tell me a case, a physical case, where you actually do modulo addition? You have done it many times without probably understanding. Not with integers. What is the angle 2.1 pi? I'll say 362 degrees. What is the angle 362 degree? Come on.
Oh, 360 plus 2 degrees. So your computer of 2 degrees, modulo 360.
So this is same as 2 degree, right? So when we calculate things with angles, we do modulo addition, modulo 2 pi and modulo 360 additions. Okay, the same thing here as well. So this obviously will lead to an error. I will not use a 2-bit integers. I will use much more larger integers. Like unsigned integer. So usually in computer, this is a nomenclature. This has nothing to do with precision. Single precision is considered as 32 bits. Or 32 bits is equals to how many bytes? 4 bytes. Right? Each byte is 4 bits. So this, for this, you will have 2 to the power, sorry, 0 to 2 to the power 32 minus 1. So these many. So your maximum number can be 2 to the power 32 minus 1. You cannot do addition even go past 2 to the power 32 minus 1. If it is a double precision, so this is single precision, let's say 1. So that's 64 bit. Most of the modern computers can use 64 bits. So once we go past that largest number, largest integer, then we reset to zero, and then obviously the result will not be accurate, because we really don't want to do modulo addition in every case. We want to do a real addition. So that, because it kind of, the numbers flows beyond the maximum number, and then there is an error, this type of error is called an overflow error. And it is more common than you can think of in computer. Okay. In fact, I will tell you a story, half the story, the other half you can figure out, you can find out from internet. There was a satellite sent, or was supposed to be sent to orbit, and they wrote the codes, and they had, if I remember correctly, they have a so the satellite computers are very precise. I mean, they're very, what should I call, they're very primitive, if you wish. Has very small number of informations available in those computers. So probably that, so far I remember, had 5 bits only. Okay. And the person who wrote the code forget that there can be overflow error. So you are measuring the temperature, for example. And if the temperature goes past a certain value, then you should trigger the cooling system. The temperature went past the certain value, but that value was overflowing 5-bit system. So the system recorded a temperature value which is lower. Cooling system did not start. The satellite got burned while going to the orbit. Okay. So this is kind of error that even people who are doing rocket science can do. So this is a real type of error. And we'll see an example at the end of today's lecture where this creeps in. All right, so that was, so this was integer representation, but unsigned integers. We'll discuss signed integer next, but if you have any question, you can raise now.
So, for example, h bar or h is order of minus 30, like, that precision, right? So we can't store that, right?
H bar or H is, see, H is not an integer number, right? It's a fraction number.
Right, right. Yes.
Okay, so we'll discuss the representation of fraction numbers.
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay. Any other question? Okay, so let's come to signed integer now. So how will I represent the signed integer? So I need to represent the sign of the integer. Now the sign of the integer can be just 1 bit, because the sign can be either plus or minus, so that's kind of binary, right? So what I can do is, I can have a sign bit, and then the rest of the bits can be the integers, representing the integers. Okay. So what happens now is, to keep the length of the integer, so now if it is a 32-bit case, then I have 31 bits here instead of 32 in the previous example of unsigned integer, and I have 1 bit here. If it is a 64-bit case, SP stands for single precision. This is double precision. So I have 1 here, I have 63 here. Okay. So what is the maximum number you can store in this? And what is the minimum integer that you can store?
For 32 bit, it will be 2 raised to 31 minus 1 for positive.
So, this is because I also want to include 0. So, this is 2 raised to 31 minus 1 for positive, and in the negative I can go up to 2 raised to 31. If I add these two, I get 2 to the 32 minus 1, and then there is a 0 bit, right? So all those, if you add, then you will get 2 to the power 32 bits. So just to take this example home, let's take an take this to home. So let us take an example of how many bits you want, so if say 4 bits. Okay. A quick way of knowing what is the binary number that you are looking at is to calculate its 2's complement. So let me just remind you what is a 2's complement if you do not know, if you know it already, or introduce to you if you do not know. First thing is that just keep this in mind, that the sign bit is often written as minus 1 whole to the power whatever is the bit, which implies that if the bit is 0, that will correspond to a minus 1 whole to the power 0, so positive sign. If the bit is 1, that will correspond to minus 1 whole to the power 1 is a negative sign. Alright, so with this, keeping in this mind, so let's see what is 2's complement of a number. So let's say that I have a number, so x1 is say 1, 1, 0, 1. So, you know that it's a negative number because 1 is the sign bit. But what is 2's complement of x1? So, 2's complement is calculated by first taking the 1's complement, which is just changing all the digits to its NOT operation, means that 1 goes to 0 and 0 goes to 1, and then you add 1. So, this number then, this is 0011, which is the number 3, but remember that there is a negative sign, so this is minus 3. Okay. So, this number in the representation will be minus 3. So, you can see I have taken 4-bit numbers here. So, we have taken 4 bits for convenience. So, 1 sign bit and 3 bits for the integers. So, that's how we are talking about these integer representations here. Now, I have a number x1, which is 1, 1, 0, 1, and this is minus 3. The number is minus 3. 1, 1, 0, 1 is the 4-bit representation of this number. So, let's say I have another number x2, which is say 0, say 1, 1, 0. So, how much is 0, 1, 1, 0? First of all, the sign bit is 0, so it's a positive number, and then 1, 1, 0, so this is just the number 6. If I add these two numbers, I know I am supposed to get plus 3. So, let's see if we get that. Now, let's add these two numbers, so I get 1, 1, and then 1 and 1 will become 1, 0. I get 0 here, get carry 1. And then 1 and 0 is over here is already 1 and 0 is 1. But there is a carry 1, so it becomes 1, 0. But I can only write 0. That 1 I cannot write in the left because I have only 4 bits. So the carry goes away. But what is this number? So this is a positive number, first of all, because it starts with 0. And this number is 3. As expected. Alright. So, let's say that x1, in this representation, let us ask the question, what is the maximum and minimum number? So, the maximum number in this representation will be, so you have 3 bits, 2 to the 3 minus 1, which is 7. And the minimum number in this representation will be minus 2 to the 3, which is minus 8. Okay. So, I have this number 0, 1, 1, 0, x2. So, let's add to x2 or x3, which is say 0, 1, 1, 0 again. See what happens. Let's see what happens if I add these two numbers. You see, this is 6 and this is 6. The number is supposed to be 12, but 12 is not there in this representation. What will happen? Let us try to guess it here. Let me write down the numbers here and then we'll see what will happen. So I have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then I have minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6. Let me go here, minus 7 and minus 8. Okay, these are my numbers. These are all 16 numbers which are represented in this representation. So, what is the summation? 0, 0 becomes 0, 1, 1 becomes 0 and carry 1, and then 1, 1 is 1, 0 plus carry 1 is 1, 1. So, this 1 comes here, so this becomes 1. So, you immediately realize that it's a negative number, and to calculate that, calculate it 2's complement. The 2's complement of this is so first I have the number 0011, 1's complement, add 1 to it, this becomes 0, carry 1, 0 again, so 110. 110 is the number 4. Okay, so this number is supposed to be minus 4. So first thing you realize that this, you have an overflow error, because after 7, you now have moved, tried to move past 7, you cannot. So, the number has become minus 4. Okay. So, you can see, once you try to move past there, you start coming from there. So, after counting up to 7, this is 8, then 9, then 10, 11, and then 12. So, you get the minus 4 as your answer. Okay, so far we are talking only about integers, and the problem with integer representation is that they are bounded. So, you do modulo addition instead of addition for the integers. But we also require floating point numbers. Most of the calculations in science requires floating point numbers. Now, let's imagine two numbers. Okay, so let's imagine two numbers which I have written in decimal representation, obviously, because that's what we can read and have some idea of. Say just got cooked up two numbers. Now, these numbers, if I say that I want to have an precision to which I want to represent these numbers is a 4 place after decimal. Okay, so I have a fixed precision, fixed decimal precision. I'm talking about decimal numbers now because easier to understand. So how will I write this number? So this will be 0.0014. And this will be 0.1260, right? So I round off after 4 place at the 4 place after decimal. Now you see something interesting has happened here. What has happened is that this has 2 significant digits, right? Right now we understand what is the significant, what is the leftmost significant digit. It is the one which is the first non-zero element if I start from the left side. But this has 4 significant digits, right? So, because one has 2 and the other has 4 significant digits, you also know that their relative error are different. So, 2 numbers has different relative errors. Okay. So, their accurate, their accuracy is different, because if I ask what is the percentage accuracy, you will say that the 2 significant digit has must have less accuracy. But what this will give you up to keeping up to a fixed decimal point is that their absolute error is same. right? The absolute error is 0.005, if you wish. So that's the absolute error. So this gives you a dilemma of should I keep the absolute error same or the relative error same? And we have already discussed in our error analysis that relative error is something which matters more. It gives you more significant digit. It tells you the number, how accurate is the number. So if the relative error is less, your number is more accurate, right? So we can write the same number in scientific notation. In the scientific notation, how will I write the first number? I will write, so scientific notation with four places, precision of four places after decimal. So 1.357. Okay, not four places after decimal. I am keeping four significant digits. So four significant digits. So this into 10 to the minus 3. And this is 1.260 into 10 to the minus 1. Right? So you realize now that if I write in scientific notation, I can keep the same number of significant digits always. Okay. But if I had one of them had a sign, so now if I ask the question that where am I storing the informations when I'm writing in scientific notation, you realize that there are places where you are storing the information. So this is one place, which is the sign of the number. This is other place, which is called the mantissa. This is the sign of mantissa. And then I have an exponent, which can also have a sign. Okay, so actually I am using more than four places to store numbers. I am using at least six or even more, seven places to store these numbers. All right. This representation is called a fixed point representation, because I am telling you, after the decimal point, or in case of binary point, how many places you will keep in your finite arithmetic, finite representation. Here it is a floating point, because though look, the point looks just coming after the first decimal place, sorry, after the one in both cases, it can be one, it can be something else as well, but the actual decimal point is somewhere else, which is decided by the exponent. Okay, so that's why this is called floating point. The point actually moves around if you change the exponent. So is this fine? So these are floating point numbers and the fixed point numbers. We have not yet talked about how to represent them in a computer. That we will do shortly. Any question? So let's talk about representing floating point numbers. Okay, so again, remember that the way we represent number is that we have that stretch of memory. In that stretch of memory, we can choose something to represent the sign, something to represent something else, etc. So the way we represent floating point number is the following. So we have the first bit, which is as always the sign. After that, now this representation, the actual representation may vary from implementation to implementation, there is something called IEEE standard, etc. So I am talking about something which is used in C and in NumPy, but it can also change between AMD and Intel processors, etc. So that, but there are a lot of things which will not, obviously, I also do not know all of these, but we'll discuss the basics here. So first I have the sign of the mantissa. After that, we store the exponents. Okay, before I write this, let me write down what I am writing here. So a number I can write as, say, the sign I can define this way, or the floating point number, minus 1 whole to the power s. So you realize s is the first bit. If the first bit is 0, so the sign is positive. If the first bit is 1, the sign is negative. Minus 1 to the power 1 is negative. Then I write 1 plus point f. I'll tell you what it is. And then 2 to the power e minus b. Okay. So I'll tell you what exactly all these things are. But before that, let me ask you a question. I give you a floating point number written in binary representation. Okay. What is the leftmost significant digit? I am not telling you what is the number, but what is the leftmost significant digit of a binary number written in floating point representation? Or what is the leftmost significant digit of a fractional binary number?
First non-zero.
Right. So what is, what are the non-zero digits in a binary number?
One.
There is only one possibility, one, right? There is absolutely no other possibility for a binary number. In case of a decimal, it can be 1 to 9, anything. But the only non-zero digit available for a binary number is 1. So, because it's always 1, I really don't need to store that number, because I know that the first digit, first leftmost significant digit is always 1. I can start storing numbers after that 1. Right? So, is this fine? So, if I, so always any binary, I will always write 1.0101 something something. Always in the scientific notation, the binaries will look like this, into 2 to the power something. So I don't need to store that 1, because I know that any number I write in scientific notation, in binary, the first digit is 1. So that's why it is written like 1 plus point f, where that point f is the all the digits after the binary point. So you only need to store those 3 digits. This one is already known to you. Okay. So what we gain in that, what we gain is one digit, right? Or one memory place where I can store an extra digit. Now here, the first bit of information, the leftmost bit, is stored as S. S is stored in the leftmost bit, which tells you what is the sign. This B is called bias, which we'll talk to later. Then I store the E, and then I have a bigger place in memory where I store F. Okay, so for example, if I have single precision, let me write this as SP. Single precision is 32 bit and 4 bytes. So 32 bit, 1 is used here, 8 is used here, and 23 is used here. Double precision, 64 bit, 8 byte. Here you need only 1 always. Here 11 is used, and the rest 52 is used here. Okay. Now, what is b? You see, the exponent 2 to the power whatever it is can be positive or negative, right? If it is negative, you are storing smaller and smaller numbers. If it is positive, you are storing larger and larger numbers. So, if you want to make it negative, then what you do here is that you choose a value of b. The value of b is fixed for a representation, so you don't need to store it. So, the value of b is chosen like 2 to the power e. Should not say e. So, this is in this case 2 to the power 8, which is the number of bits you have, and then minus 1. It's chosen this way. We'll see why it is chosen this way. So that 8 and 11 comes from here. Okay. So for this, what will be the value of b for the single precision representation? What is 2 to the power 7? Right, and this should be 1023. Okay, so what you do is whatever the exponent stored there, if the exponent is say for example 100, so it will be the number will be 2 to the power 100 minus 127, so minus 27. Okay. So, what is the minimum number you can store? So, it will be the of the order of 2 to the power. I mean, minimum, I'm not taking the sign, but of the order of 2 to the power minus 127, right? P is 0. 2 to the minus 127, which will be 10 to the power around minus 38. For this is for single precision, and 2 to the power minus 1023, which is 10 to the so if you can formally write. So, what is f? So, remember that f is you write that like digit, mth digit 2 to the power m like that. So, because of that, so this I can write in shorthand from 1 to whatever is this number. So, say 52 in this case. And then bit at 52 minus I by 2 to the power I. Then you add, you are adding, if you add all these things, you will get the f. Okay, so this is essentially, this is what is it telling you. So it's if I equals to 1, so remember that this is supposed to be a fraction in the sense this is all coming after the decimal point, so it starts with 1 by 2 into something, so it is some number into 2 to the power minus 1 plus some number into 2 to the minus 2. And it goes, can go up to 2 to the 52. In case of double precision. Okay. Now, any questions so far? So now this means that if I now want to subtract two numbers which are very nearby, if I ask the question, I want to subtract two numbers which are very nearby, then we discussed about the error in subtraction, right? So what is the minimum distance between two numbers which we can subtract. So what are the closest number? That I can subtract means also that this representation can distinguish, right? Can you tell me that what is the minimum number this representation can distinguish? It should be clear about from what I have written here. See, what are these digits in binary? What are the possibilities for these digits?
0 and 1.
0 and 1. So the minimum it can distinguish is the case where all of these are 0 apart from the last one, right? So that if I write the delta f, so that is just 2 to the power minus 52 or 2 to the power minus 23. So this is double precision, this is single precision case. So single precisions are usually called float and double precisions are usually called double when you are using a language. But this is the minimum number that you can distinguish. So this has a name, these are called machine precisions. Usually denoted as delta epsilon m for machine. 2 to the minus 52 is of the order of 10 to the minus 16 and this is of the order of 10 to the minus 7. Okay. If you are familiar with C, when you give a print statement to print a floating point number, you will see that there are 6 decimal places it prints by default. This is the reason for that. That up to the sixth decimal place, it is accurate. If you print a double precision number, it will print for up to 16 decimal places or 15 decimal places, because up to that it is accurate. Okay. So any question? So, if I subtract two numbers which are near to each other, smaller than delta f, so the subtraction is less than delta f, I will get 0. I will get 0 essentially. Okay. I cannot subtract two numbers which are smaller than delta f. Not smaller than delta f, the subtraction is smaller than delta f. So, we talked about an overflow error, the subtraction, this leads to, after once you reach delta f, you will only get 0. So that's called an underflow error. So you are going beyond the machine precision. Okay. Any question at this stage? We'll just talk about an example quickly and then call it a day. One example I give you as homework is that, say I have these numbers 1101, say 1101. Okay, so it's a 8-bit floating point. I am just cooked up this just because writing a 32-bit number will be too difficult. So this is the sine bit, this is the exponent bit, and these are the mantissa bit. So you have to find out what is this number. Okay. So this example you should try by yourself. So what we'll talk about is the example of calculating average. And again, this is somewhere where very, very sophisticated people go wrong sometimes. What is the average of n numbers? You will say that sum the n numbers and then divide by n, right? So one method to calculate the average of n numbers can be, so x bar I can just write 1 by n summation over I equals 1 to n xi. An alternate method, so what can be an alternate method? Can anybody suggest?
You could compute individually xi by n and then sum over them.
Are these two methods computationally equivalent? The answer is no. So you see, if xi is greater than 0, then in this case, I can have an overflow error. The overflow error is also possible for floating point numbers because there is always a maximum floating point numbers. We discussed about the minimum or maximum floating point numbers in the previous slide. So its overflow is also possible here. Once you go past that number, you will do a modulo addition. What is the problem in this?
If n is large, then xi, summation of xi can cause overflow error.
Right, that is here.
In method 2, sir, like in floating point error can also occur, right? If n is large, then the number will become so small that...
Right. So, if n is large, how large it has to be? So, remember here we discussed that the smallest number is like 10 to the minus 38 or 10 to the minus 308 in two cases, single precision and double precision. So, once I divide xi by n, if n is as large as n 10 to the power say 309, then with double precision number, I will get 0. I don't have that number in the double precision. So I can have an overflow error again. Okay. What happens if xi can be positive or negative? What is the problem then? So here, both of these are valid still, but remember that now there is an extra thing that can happen, which is that you can may end up subtracting two numbers doing the addition, which are close to each other. Okay. And that is more likely to happen using this method because you are making the number small by dividing by n. If n is large, then it is more likely that two numbers can come close to each other. Okay. So, you see that for a very basic operation of averaging numbers, we have to think about this if the number n is very large. Okay, so I'll stop here. And so we have come to the last, this was the last discussion on introduction to numerical computing. We'll start with Fourier transform from the next class. Any question you can ask, else you can ask. Jam.
So what was the problem in method 2?
See, method 2, imagine n is 10 to the power 310. Okay. So even if xi is 1, I get a number which is 10 to the power minus 310.
So one individual number becomes difficult to
right represent. So individual number becomes very it's not possible to represent.
Okay, sir.
So you need to know what are your numbers, how much summation you are doing, etc. This type of error happened in one of the largest telescopes in the world. There was a software which was doing this error, which had to be corrected. It was just summing up numbers. It's as simple as that. Yeah. Any other question? All right, so we'll call it a day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.